rape stories on the Doug Stanhope podcast. We're in Canada. We're in London, Ontario. And I'll update you on that, the rest of the Canadian tour in the next podcast or another podcast. But I was lucky enough to run into my old friend Jane Piper, and who's got a fantastic rape story about being raped. And as you said, I'm not your regular rape victim. And I go, yeah, you want to talk about this on the podcast? And you said, absolutely.
Is that what I said?
Yes, right. You did say that.
I said, absolutely. All right, yeah.
Well, you said I'm someone that doesn't get creeped out by that shit. But
very true.
As the people who listen to this podcast know, we love fucking dark stories. And that's a great dark story. And I know Jane was at the you were at the Super Bowl party in 2011.
Or 2010. The year it was Green Bay Steelers.
All right, whatever. Yeah, it was one of the, years ago. And record, let me just say that I heard Joe Rogan's podcast where he goes, yeah, he has a Super Bowl party every year and he just invites the whole world. I did that once drunk on Joe Rogan's podcast, and I've since rescinded that offer. In fact, last year we didn't even have it because it's just too much of a problem.
Just put extra locks on the gates.
And I talked to you about memories of just that party, and you have as few as I do.
That's accurate.
And the one memory I do have of you being there was bringing up your rape story around the campfire. We had
I don't know if it was me bringing up so much as you insisting that I tell it.
And I remember you saying, you ask me about this every time, but I always forget. And I forget again, but I know it was like in a grocery store. Not in a grocery store. Is that right? All right.
The parking lot.
Go ahead. You tell me.
The story?
Go.
Oh, let me envision myself in front of your campfire again. Imagine the surroundings.
It was a dark June night, 19.
No, it was not night. It was broad daylight.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, no, it was brought.
See, this
again,
is a great story.
You don't remember the
I know.
Don't remember it. God. No, it was August in Brentwood, like about a block from where O.J. Simpson killed his allegedly.
Allegedly. We don't want to get sued by the Simpson people.
I know, because they're listening right now. So a block away from where that happened.
Posh neighborhood.
Yeah, exactly. You know, Ralph's grocery store on Bundy at Wilshire in Los Angeles.
Who are the sponsors? Oddly, the sponsors.
That's nice.
Of this podcast.
I was working as a personal assistant. I was running random errands for my boss, and I had to like rush through and do some grocery shopping in the middle of the day. It was like 3 o'clock in the afternoon in Brentwood. And I put all the groceries in the back of my car, and then I was driving a Suburban because that was my boss's car that I drove for work. So it's, you know, it's big. So I had like a bunch of bags, and I kind of like, you know, climbed in the car and then put all my bags down on the passenger seat and then turned to like close the door. And there was a guy there. And like in like a split second, he basically climbed into the seat next to me with what I thought was a knife stuck into my side. And closed the door and locked it. And I basically just kind of sat there. I didn't really know what to do at first. I remember sort of starting to cry and just be like, I didn't really know what to do here. And he's like, why are you crying? And I just like, I didn't. And he's like, get in the back seat. And so I went to actually climb over to the passenger door and get out of the car to get in the back seat. And he freaked out because he thought I was trying to escape, when in fact I probably would have just climbed back in the car because that was the normal way, is to leave the car to get into the back seat. But no, he wanted to shove me back into the back. Anyway, long story not so long. Pushed me into the one back seat and then made me push, you know, there was a Suburban, right? So there's like multiple rows of seats.
I have a Suburban.
There you do.
Also brought to you by Suburban, the Doug Stanhope podcast, Rape Stories episode, brought to you by the Ralphs on Bundy and Chevy Suburban. All the room for rape.
Oh my God, stop.
Go ahead.
Anyway, so he insisted that I keep going back to a further back seat. And I honestly had no, I mean, you don't really understand what's happening in these moments because it does, it's not normal. It's like your brain doesn't quite move fast enough to grasp. At least that's mine didn't in that moment. And he kept asking me, oh, yeah, that's right. He kept saying, I just want to ride to Santa Monica. And I was like, well, how am I going to give you a ride to Santa Monica if I'm not driving the car? Yeah. And finally, he just, you know, I had gotten into the furthest back seat. And he said, take your clothes off. And at that point, I was just like, oh, Jesus Christ. And all of a sudden, like the reality of what was happening kind of just like, you know, landed on me. And I was like, what the fuck? And so I jumped back into the seat where I basically like jumped on him and got the corks. Oh, it was a corkscrew. It wasn't a knife. He had just stolen it from the grocery store. Fuck, it's all on camera.
Shoplifters.
I know. I got the corkscrew out of his hand and started hitting him with it. But not being a violent person, I remember even in the moment being very aware that I didn't want to hurt, like I had to be careful where to hit him because I didn't want to hurt him because I'm just not that, it's obviously I had never taken a defense class. I hadn't, you know, I wasn't in the right state of mind. I should have been, but I didn't want to hurt him. And so I whacked him a bunch of times with it and he just got very angry. He did not appreciate that one bit. And he got it back from me and then just beat the crap out of me. And at that point, it was bad. He just pummeled me. And then he threw me back into the back seat again, eventually. And my back whacked the back of the seat. And then my head, or my neck, rather, is a Suburban, right? So you have these huge buckets on the side where, like, the kids kept their toys and that sort of thing. Well, my neck hit the side of that bucket and cracked. And then my head just kept flying into the bucket. And I knew I was badly hurt and I knew like, and it was bad. I mean, it was August. It was really hot. Like I remember being like, oh my God, this is very uncomfortable. Like I'm really hot right now. And eventually like, and he was just beating me. And I eventually, like at one point he had punched me in the face and my blood, it was sort of like everything was in slow motion. And my blood was kind of going, my head was turning very slowly and the blood was like following along in this line and it landed on the car seat. And I remember just thinking in that moment, like, you are going to die. You have to stop. You have to just let this happen and figure out how the fuck you're going to get out of here and live. And so at that point, I kind of just gave in. I left my body in one way or another. Like, I just wasn't present anymore physically. I just was sort of planning my escape. And like continued to beat me throughout and rape me. And then once he was done, he said he wanted to take me out. He was going to take me for a ride and that we were going to go somewhere for a drive or whatever. And at that point, you know, I knew that I had to get out and I had been, you know, planning enough and, oh no, no, God, how can't believe I'm skipping over the weirdest, weird. I don't know. It's all weird in quotations, I suppose. But no, he immediately after he finished said, you know, this isn't my fault. Your husband paid me to do this. And I was not married. I'm not married. I wasn't engaged. There was no husband. But I knew that I obviously had to go along with this because this was like, he was giving me something essentially. So, and I used to wear a ring that my mom gave me on my wedding ring finger. So I kind of figured that's what was, he said, oh, you're married, right? And I said, well, I'm separated. Yeah. And I just, I remember like at the moment that he said that I had been looking at the back of the seat, the same seat that had been, was covered with my blood. And I remember
your boss's seat. That's not
what
car?
It was my boss's car that I drove. Essentially, my boss had his own car that he drove normally. This was like
all right. Because if Chaley got blood all over my Suburban, I would. Yeah,
I was not concerned about the blood on the seats. No, I was pretty sure that would be understood.
I really thought that's what you were going to say said, and my only thought was, oh shit.
And no.
Well, people do like say, I had the weirdest thought at this time. Like, oh shit, I'm going to have to get the blood out of the.
No, I did have thoughts like that later. Like when I finally got out of the car and I realized I didn't have my purse and I tried to get back in the car because I wanted to get my purse. And the guy looked at me like I was fucking crazy.
Wait, he stole the car.
He did steal. Well, I'm fast forwarding. Anyway, let me finish with the.
Yeah.
So he is telling me that it was my husband that paid him to do this and it wasn't his fault. And I'm looking, I was looking at the back of the seat at, in that moment. And I remember, you know, I had been, you know, I had been an actor my entire life at that point, and that's what I was doing. And I remember thinking in that moment, like, oh my God, all the years of acting class and all of the exercises and all the training that you've done is nothing to do with any sitcom or anything you're ever going to book. It's all about this moment and you have to pull off this fucking performance. So I just went along with them and I was like, oh my God, I totally understand. My husband is an asshole and this is so typical of him. And you are right. This is not your fault. This is typical of him. He's an asshole. He's disgusting. It's okay. And he looked at me and he was like, oh wow, you're cool. And there's nothing like getting validation from the guy who just raped you to make you realize that you really are a good person and everything's going to be okay.
Especially after living in LA trying to fucking act. Exactly. You're like, oh, this exactly. is the part I get. Exactly. I finally, yes, you exactly. got the role.
Exactly. So I mean, I
forgot to set that up, that you are a comic and an actress that I've known since the 90s in LA or early 2000s.
Right. Yeah.
I opened with rape. I gave you no backstory. I'm going to humanize you later.
you can add that in post. I am a real human being, damn it. There's more than just rape to me.
I don't put like Craigslist ads. Hey, anyone been raped? Sodomized, diddled as a kid? Andy Andrista was telling his child molestation stories on the on the premiere of this podcast.
Oh.
So it's always tried to take a dark bent. So back to you and the rapist. You convince right. him that you're cool.
Yes, he believed that I was indeed a cool person, and I was basically letting him off of his responsibility and everything that he had just done to me. And I was laying it all on this, you know, made up husband that obviously did not exist. And he seemed quite happy about that. And that's when he would just kind of moved into like, oh fuck, we're in Brentwood. It's 3:30 in the afternoon and there's people everywhere. And maybe we should get out of here. So then he started, you know, he had the keys and he's like, okay, we're going to go for a ride. And then I knew that there was no way I could go anywhere, because if he took me anywhere, he was definitely going to kill me. I already knew that that was going to happen. Back in my head, I knew the whole time. So he jumped into the front seat and he started to, you know, start the car and drive away. And I managed to jump into the center seat again where the door was. And I was in such a state of hysterics. Like I felt like an infant learning, like I had no idea how anything worked. Like I remember just pressing on buttons on the door, like something is going to work if I do this way. I really didn't know what I was doing. And then all of a sudden, some button I pressed made the window go down. To this day, I honestly have no idea how I fit out that window, because it was a fucking childproof window. It didn't go down all the way. And
wow.
Somehow that's the only moment that I don't remember fully. And I don't know if I landed on my head. I don't know if a fucking alien force like really removed me from the car and saved me, or how I got out of that window, because I shouldn't have fit out that window, but I did. And all of a sudden I was outside of the car and he's looking at me, froze. He stopped the car and that, you know, kind of jolted. And then that's when I was trying to get back into the car again, because I wanted my purse, because, you know,
yeah.
A lady doesn't go anywhere without her purse. And then I realized, like, as I'm trying the door and it's locked, I'm like, oh yeah, you don't want to go back inside, you idiot. And so then I ran, and then I ran like sort of in the same way that like you think that you want to run away from a bee, like in a zigzag so that the bee can't see you. I like ran in this huge like circle, sort of like weaving around, because I didn't want him to be able to run me over easily.
Curly from the Three Stooges.
Yeah, exactly. So then
stuck
I just ran, and I was really like 20 feet from the grocery store entrance. Like it really wasn't that far away anyway. And I ran right in. And I just immediately, I was like, I was just raped in your parking lot. Give me the phone. And I called, you know, and I called 911 immediately. And then, you know, the aftermath pretty much started from there. Although then I tried to call my boss, because I didn't know the license plate number. I had no idea
yeah.
how to tell the cops how to find the car. So I'm, you know, trying to get hold of someone who knew the license plate. And meanwhile, the guy didn't get very far, because I guess I'd never witnessed any of this myself, but heard sort of randomly. I guess a fire department guy who just happened to be driving along when the rapist left the parking lot. He was driving he was driving erratically and it just stood out. So the fire department guy put on his siren. He wasn't a cop, but he put on his siren, sort of like, you clearly are doing something wrong. And it scared the guy. So he went down the whatever that side street is in behind Wilshire and went back into the grocery store and then drove through the parking lot and took off down the alley that's parallel to Wilshire and then crashed into a post and then took off on foot. And the
disappeared.
Only, yeah, just disappeared.
Now, still, what year was this?
2003.
Okay. So he disappeared. You filed charges or you make a report.
Right. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Went to the hospital, did the rape kit and all that glamorous stuff. Yeah. And then they searched. Well, they did whatever needs, you know, whatever
they
do.
Did they pay you for the rest of the day?
My bosses, both of my bosses who I worked for were amazing. Not only did they pay me, a while. No, but seriously, like they were amazing people. And anytime anyone ever asks about them, I have to put it out there. Like they were paid for my health insurance for a year after I wasn't even working.
You were doing.
I was a personal assistant for a TV producer.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. And they were.
Well, drop a name. Or maybe not.
I don't know. I always feel.
That don't. I don't know. If it would be beneficial to their reputation.
I don't know. Could this ever be beneficial? I mean, it has nothing to do with them, and I don't want,
I know.
It's just a weird thing.
All right. So then it's into, what state of mind are you in initially? Is it like what you should have done, what you could have done? Was it guilt? Was it anger? Was
Is it
the five stages of death?
No, grief, you mean?
the five stages of grief, death, acceptance, that's the last one. Grief, denial.
I don't know if I went through any of that. But yeah, probably if I went down the list. Well, I mean, I was diagnosed with post-traumatic distress disorder, and I went through, I mean, I still have bouts of it. Like, it's a weird thing. It's like your brain is reprogrammed. Like, there's just something stamped on there. So, like, if a parking valet... Or the squeegee guys. Like, if I'm in my car and all of a sudden a squeegee guy shows up in the middle of the street, I will freak. Because it's like a person coming to my car window in the middle of nowhere, even now, like 11 years later, can, you know, set me off for, you know, up, you know, like an hour to a couple of days, depending on just what's going on in that moment. But yeah, for a while, it was fucked. I mean, I was really badly beaten, so it hurts, you know, physically. But also, like, I replayed it in my mind constantly, where I would play out different endings. Like for the first part of the beating, I had the keys in my hand because I had been, you know, I was about to start the car, right? And it was a Suburban, so it had, like, you know, it had an alarm button on it. So at any point, I could have just pressed the fucking red button and the alarm would have gone off, and he probably would have taken off because he would have been terrified. But that never occurred to me. So it's like I was poisoned by that. Like, why didn't I just, you know, if I just, you know, so it's like there's a lot of time goes on where you start playing over all the different things you could have done. Or I had a camera. This is before you had a camera in your phone or whatever. I had a camera in my purse, the one that I had, like, when I was trying to, like, you know, get back into the car. I always think, like, what if I had, like, got back into the car, got my purse, got out my camera, and had a photo of him right there, and, like, went to the police. They found him immediately. You know, there were so many things that I came up with.
I mean, I don't understand this, but I understand anytime, because I can't fight and I'm terrified of any kind of violent confrontation. So just someone going, hey, get the fuck out of my way, or something where I fear a violent confrontation, I will replay in my head all the things I could have done or should have said. And that's why I'm a school shooter still to this day in my head. Like, I play out murdering people all the time.
Jesus Christ.
It's just like so I can't imagine to be in that situation that I would.
Well, it's interesting that you said that, because I actually never, and this is I'm fast forwarding again. When the guy was finally caught 10 years later, which he was, and we can go into
part two.
but one, like, through the years, even immediately afterwards, I never had any conscious thoughts about that guy, because to him, he didn't exist as a human being. Like, what I always compare it to is, like, probably the same way that someone who experiences a hurricane or an earthquake or a plane crash, like, the way that they think of the event. they don't think like, God damn it, that stupid earthquake. Like, if only it hadn't been so fucking bumpy. You know, they don't think of it like that. They don't, they just think of something happened. And then after the thing happens, everything else is the fucking aftermath. So that's the, like, I never thought like, damn that guy, because he wasn't a fucking human being to me. He didn't exist. I actually had more negative feelings and more resentment and anger towards the people that were there to help me and yet did things that I didn't think were as were necessarily the best, the best way done. Like the guys who picked me up in the ambulance talked over top of me about Survivor, ironically, like, and like you always call hear the term rape survivor. And I remember like that was one of the first words I heard afterward, not because I was being called a survivor, but because they were talking about the fucking TV show Survivor and they had been watching it and they were talking about an episode. And I was hysterical at that point. And I remember just calling out, like, I was just like, why did this happen? Like, I just needed, I was trying to rationalize what the fuck had happened to me. And I was crying and I'm like on the stretcher in the back of the ambulance. And they were ignoring me. Like they just, I wasn't even a human being to them. They were just like, I was just, this is part of the job. I guess this, you know, it's like a human body crying and we will just ignore it. And I thought that was really kind of disgusting considering that was their job. I had more anger towards them than I did towards the rapist because I had no expectations of the rapist. He was like a guy who came in and out of my life for one purpose and that was it, and I didn't have any expectation that he was there for any reason to help me because he wasn't. They were supposed to help me and yet they didn't.
Yeah, that being in LA and having to deal with just gruesome shit like that, A, you're going to become desensitized, but B, you're probably already desensitized to take the fucking job to begin with. You're probably the fact that you could do that and still hold a conversation, like someone who would be going, oh my God, crying at your, oh, this,
yeah, like trying to help me,
to you.
They would last 2 days.
Yeah, they,
you know, right.
Like every fucking, right. Every time
although
I pick someone
TV,
up.
Although on TV, they're all very nice people and they're very caring and compassionate.
Yeah. Oh, compound fracture, blur. He's spitting vomit between his fingers. All right, we're going to have to let you go. You're either crying or vomiting at every call and we need someone that just doesn't give a fuck.
I did on multiple occasions ask the detective who was heading my case. I was always asking him like, well, on Law and Order, when this happens, they do this. Shouldn't you be doing this? And he's like, that's on television. I'm like, yeah, but so, it kind of seems like a good idea that maybe you could do that because that would actually help to find the guy.
I bet right now, as you're bitching about the ambulance guys, that detective is on another podcast going, yeah, and then you get these victims, and they're going, oh, I saw this on CSI. It's not fucking TV, lady. Hey, we're going to go to break. So I was going to ask, like, were you, like, relentless with, like, calling the police and the detective to see if there's any, like, where's this guy? I want justice. Were you, like...
I mean, at first, like, I would watch the news. I remember there being a case of this guy. It was, like, somewhere near Beverly Hills. And I remember, and they showed a photo, like the sketch that they had done on the news. And I was like, and I called up and I was like, that guy looks like the guy. Can you talk to them? Like, why don't you find out about him? And that was when I started to learn that there's no communication, even among LAPD, like, in between, like, from, like, the different departments. They did not even speak to each other.
I'm just saying, don't eat the mic.
Oh.
It's dropping like this.
Oh, okay.
Sorry. I'm sorry. Chaley's not here. I fucking panic when he's not here because usually he's here with earphones and he can tell you if you're... Yeah. So you're good. You're good.
Let me talk right this.
No, you're fine. I just...
Yeah, but anyway, I basically, you know, I realized really fast that there's no communication between departments. I hate to put down the people that did their jobs because whatever, you know, they did and they were very nice and they were very kind, but it was eye opening. Well, the weirdest thing was when I first, like the day that a couple days after it happened, when I had walked into the police station in West LA to give my full statement. And it was the first time that I met a district attorney and like, you know, they basically recorded the whole thing and they took photos and whatever. And, it was like walking into like 1975. Like they have no fucking technology. Like there was like a dot matrix computer piled in a corner of this. Like he took me into this back room to take a photo of my face, and I'm like, what the fuck? It was like a tech, you know, like an old tech graveyard. But they didn't have much more. Like they didn't have anything even more current on their desks. Like they were lucky to just barely have email. You know, they all still sign up on a sheet, like, or not even a like on a like a white erase board or whatever when they first enter. And I remember saying, like, "Is this what you guys work with? Like, the millions of dollars that are going to buy like tanks and assault rifles and whatever for like small town America? Like, that's important, but no, let's not equip the actual police departments with the technology and just the current." You know, current, like contemporary.
Yeah, no, they spend all their money on offense and not defense. Yes. They don't care about the victim. They care about getting, we want to catch criminals. We don't give a fuck about the
once
victim.
Once the crime has happened to you, you are no longer important to us.
It's the same as the government is we have to protect our citizens. You don't give a fuck about the citizens. You give a fuck about, you want war, you want offense. You want the... Yep. Everyone who wants to you throw the long... Anyway, I'm going to do a bunch of dumb analogies here.
All right, go for it.
I'm not going to go for it. We're going to take a break.
Okay.
I have to do a show. We're in the green room with comedian, actress, and good friend Jane Piper. And we'll come back for the thrilling second half of Jane's rape story. And the working title to your book, which I'm going to put out there because people are going to want to fucking read it.
Uh-huh.
And now you're going to have to finish it. And the title of the book that you're writing is called?
I Was Raped and All I Got Was This Lousy T-Shirt.
I like it. All right. We'll be back after I perform a show I'm not really paying attention to in London, Ontario. Great news, kids. The much-neglected merch page on my much-neglected website has been taken over by Greg Chaley. So we have tour t-shirts, podcast t-shirts. We have Pop-Off Vodka Presents t-shirts. Get them before we get sued, before we get the cease and desist. And a whole shitload of CDs and DVDs that span a lifetime. A sad, tragic, bloated lifetime of my fucking horrible thoughts and pontifications. So help me get that shit out of my crawl space. Thanks for that. And now, back to the podcast, previously recorded. Hey, I didn't do my show yet. I realized, hey, I have two openers in 10 more minutes, and we're so into this that we went out and had a cigarette. I had a cigarette. And there's 10 years after this rape.
I like that you say rape with a hard R.
Rape.
Rape. Rape with the proper enunciation that it should have. It's not a joking matter.
Yeah. Well, anytime
we'll
say,
talk about that later.
If you're going to say the word, sell it.
Yeah.
You did stand-up comedy, so yeah. You know, you have to commit to something. If the people are going to back off of the subject or the word, you have to hammer them with it. You have to, sell it. Show
like,
commitment.
C's are funny. R's are serious. Cuckoo is a funny word.
You don't
rape
say,
is very serious.
She was kind of a cunt. You say cunt. And then you follow it up with the yeah, bleeding cunt at that. And then you, guess we have to go with it.
Now you've gone too far.
All right, after your cunt stopped bleeding from the rape.
Oh, my God. Jesus Christ. You get away with saying this shit. Uh-huh, anyway.
Well, you're
I'm here.
You
I'm
told
doing
me
it, yeah.
Openly about this.
No, I know. Well, I mean, I literally meant that to be true. Only you can say certain things, because it comes from a good place. I understand.
Over that course of time, after the horror of it, you developed a sense of humor about it. You were working in L.A. as a comic and an actress. And
use the term working loosely, but yes.
Well,
yeah.
As much as anyone is
right.
In L.A., everyone's trying to be something
right.
Bigger and better.
Right.
So, because you say I'm not your usual rape victim.
Right. Whatever that means. I mean, that's probably offensive to so many, you know, so many other people. Well, honestly, like even like I before I was working as a comedian, like I was literally in the hospital waiting for the rape kit to be done when I was already joking about it. I remember my boss, I don't know if she heard it or maybe it was just telling my boyfriend at the time when I told him or like.
Your boyfriend that paid the man to rape you? I'm sorry, I wasn't paying attention during the first
part.
I was going over my
set during
your whole story.
That was my husband who didn't exist. That was my husband who didn't exist. I actually did have a boyfriend who did not pay the guy, was not part of that.
Did you ever just ask him, just for the record, you didn't pay that guy, right?
You know what? I did not ask him. Oh my God.
What if?
But the cops did go to my boss because they thought maybe like he would have thought that he was the husband because it was his car, which is super creepy. And like, anyway, it was very clear.
What if the rapist had picked up the phone and said, all right, yeah, I need the second half of the money. It's done.
Oh my God.
What? What? No, it's a Suburban. No, she's got brown hair. Ah, fuck.
Right. I know.
Hey,
there was a fraction of a second where I actually did, like when I was, you know, telling the detectives and when I was sort of thinking back about all that whole, his whole weird, like, it was your husband's fault sort of story. I was always like, fuck, what if like, or like there was a guy who stalked me for years and I was like, oh my God, what if he has appeared back on the scene and he pretended to be my husband and it was him that, you know, it's like there. Fuck, if the shit goes through your head when, you know, when you're brutalized that you start to want somehow.
And that's all you can think about.
Yeah, it's exactly. Not, you like, can't trying start to make doing, sense of it all. Yeah, yeah.
You're not doing crossword puzzles. You're focused on just thinking about that.
Right.
So you're joking with the rape kit?
Right. Oh, yeah, yeah. Well, it was even before that. Like, I remember I was punched in the face, like, repeatedly. Like I looked like Rocky Dennis from Mask. And like, wow. Seriously, I mean, I remember looking in the mirror and just like my breath was taken away, not because I was as beautiful as I normally am, but because I was unrecognizable. Like it was like, I did look like Rocky Dennis. My face was swollen and weird and unusually large. But anyway, so I was in this room waiting for a jaw x-ray. And because my hair had been pulled so much, like they're trying to save all the DNA, right? Because they, you know, they have to take and record everything.
Yep.
So they had me carrying this sheet around to catch the hair that fell out because my hair had been matted so much when he'd been like pulling and pushing me around that it was coming out in chunks. So they had me carrying this sheet to catch the hair. And when the guy, the x-ray tech came in to do the x-ray, he said, oh, just put that on the chair. And so I was then, you know, lying on this thing or whatever it was to do the x-ray. And then as I'm doing that, this nurse comes in and my boyfriend at the time was sitting in the corner and the nurse comes in. She's like, oh, what's this sheet here? She picks it up, draw, you know, like pull, like in, like there was just this moment and like where all of us in the room like
Sully's, you know, the gasp, crime scene.
Yeah, gasped. And I'm like,
what's this bloody glove?
Exactly. And then there was just a moment of silence. And I said, oh, now you see, this is why O.J. Simpson is still walking the streets. And the x-ray tech was just like just a moment of just total sort of absolute freak out. I don't know what to do with myself. I can't believe she said that. And I can't believe this just happened. And he just ran out. And the nurse was standing there like, what just happened? And I'm like, you know what? So I'm just kidding. I'm joking. And I told her, I'm like, you basically just threw all the DNA on the floor. And now, you know, he's not going to get caught. And it's all your fault. But anyway, and so then, you know,
But you said it joking.
I said it. Yes, I was joking. Yes. I was joking. And I was laughing. And then Joe, my ex, is like, or my boyfriend who at the time, he was like, I remember him just being like, and even like, I was like being silenced. Like, this is an inappropriate time to be funny, Jane. This is not that. And I'm like, I'm the one that was just had my vagina beaten. You know, it's like that, like, don't tell me when to be funny or not. But it was later when they were doing the rape kit. And like, they're literally taking Polaroid photos of my fucking bruised vagina. And all of a sudden the nurse is like with her Polaroid between my legs, starts laughing. And I mean, that's not the moment that you really want anyone to start laughing because, you know, it's your best.
Maybe she used to take baby pictures and she thought that would make the baby smile.
She's just, yeah, She's trying to get a giggle, but no, she just started laughing. But then she, all of a sudden, she starts repeating, like speaking to herself. She's like, that's why OJ Simpson's still walking the streets. And then she proceeded to like tell all the other nurses in the room what I had done. And I don't know if it was like looking closely at my vagina and taking photos of it that finally made her realize that I had just been trying to be funny. And she finally got it like 6 hours later. But it was like, if it was a validation in that moment, like her laughing, and like I was like, okay, yeah, you know what? Some people aren't going to like it. Other people are going to be okay with it.
Did you ever try to talk about it on stage?
I did. And it wasn't until several years later. I actually, like, I had been writing a bunch about it, but I hadn't actually gone up and done it yet. But I submitted like through, like, I was probably Backstage West, honestly, like some random, you know, post on, through like, you know, casting stuff. And Adrian Grenier, who was on, you know, from Entourage, he was producing documentaries. And, he had done this documentary about finding his birth father. And and I had just seen it, and I saw it, and I was like, oh, this guy's actually cool despite that show. and so I, you know, I submitted, and they're basically looking for artists who have interesting stories of why they do what they do. So I went in, and I was like, you know, I was a comic and I was raped, and now I want to go back on stage and I want to talk about being raped and, you know, but be funny. And so
it's
they,
tough.
So yeah. And they actually, they loved the storyline, and they did a bunch of interviews with me. And then they shot one of my shows that I did. And I just started working it. Like I started like just doing open mics. Maybe not open mics, but like those you know, bringer shows, whatever. And I was doing it, and I did like, I had like 10, 15 minutes pretty much almost entirely on the experience. And it was good. I liked it. I mean, it was, I relied a lot on awkward silence. It was, you know, which has always been sort of my thing of like, I know it's funny because it's, everyone's uncomfortable.
Yeah. my mother's suicide took me about 4 or 5 years to get right. The longest bit, I had funny parts to it immediately, but then there's other awkward parts, and it took a long time. So, and she was the one that died. For you to try to make that funny that quick,
right?
But you were still trying,
right? Well, yeah, for sure. What's weird is that people are ready to laugh right away until they realize it's real, and then they don't really know if they should be laughing. When in fact, once they realize it's real, that's when they should be laughing, because that kind of gives them permission. Like, this is a fucking real experience. If I was just joking inappropriately about being raped and I hadn't actually had that experience, that would not be a good joke.
Yeah.
But the fact, you know, like, comedy comes from a place of fucking pain, I find anyway. Like, really good comedy comes from a place of like, I'm a fucking dysfunctional person and I can't deal with this, so here.
There's a reason that jokes always start, don't you hate when?
Right.
It's not, don't you love?
Right. Like, yeah. When my life was perfect as a child and I got everything I wanted, it was really funny when this happened.
Yeah, and I, like, my mother's, when she killed herself, there was part of me that immediately recognized this will be material. Like, and it wasn't like
Mom,
catharsis.
Mom, just let this take time, but I know this is going to be really good for my career someday.
Oh, she's happy knowing she'll be a bitch.
Yeah, exactly.
I mean, the fucking women that come up to you and say, oh, you should hang around with me and the girls in my bowling league and you'll have a whole new routine. Mother would be that happy to be in the act. But the point is, I don't necessarily, sometimes comedy is catharsis for me.
Mm-hmm.
That was a story I wanted to tell. I thought that was a beautiful story, what happened, and I wanted to tell it. It wasn't my way of dealing with it. A lot of the anger in my act is a lot of the anger I feel that's rooted in whatever, who knows. Maybe I'm just an angry person. I know when it's cathartic and when it isn't.
Right.
But for you, was that a way of dealing with it? Or
yes.
Was there...
Yes.
Was there any capitalist side, not financial capitalist, but ego capitalist, where you go, I can create something that stands out with this?
Huh. That's a really good question. I don't think I thought of that. Certainly not back then. I think there more of the ego comes up, and I don't know if you, like, we'll talk about this later, I guess, like in the like he got caught section of this of the story, where like I just realized as time went on, like well, how you started this whole thing, like, I'm not a normal quote unquote rape victim, which I have realized, like, I don't know if there is a normal, but most people don't want to talk about it. Most people don't, certainly don't want their name attached to it. Most people don't want people to know what happened to them. I immediately from day one, like, got on the phone and started calling every single person I knew. Like, by the way, I was just raped. You need to know this because it's going to change my life and I'm going to be different now. So you need to know that this is what I'm dealing with. You know, I mean, it wasn't necessarily like that, but essentially, like, my closest friends all got like a phone call because I knew, like, this is me now and I'm fucking going through this. And I know that that doesn't
shit's gonna be weird. Yeah.
Exactly, and that
I lost a leg to fucking diabetes. And exactly, I'm an amputee now. You need to know.
Exactly, and that was the thing that I always said to people was like, if I was in a fucking car crash, and I just was almost killed in a car crash, I would have no. There would never be an issue of me telling people. But for some reason, because there's this whole like sexual vagina element of rape, people don't talk about it. And it never made any sense to me. It still doesn't.
Well,
I don't
women
connect.
Are stigmatized sexually anyway.
Right.
If you sleep with too many men, you're she's a whore. It's right. So women have to deal with that societal stigma, whether it's real or not. How much of it's influenced by the media, and you think these other people that you never meet think about you like that?
Right.
Let's just cut to it. The fuck rape jokes. Mm. The rape joke controversy that started with Dan Tosh.
Right.
Second-handed from a blogger repeating his act. Which he never addressed. I've talked to him about it. He's like, I'm not. It was nothing like she made it out to be. But it started this massive dialogue in the stand-up comedy world about whether it's okay to make rape jokes.
Right. Well, first of all, it's just I don't ever like it when anyone's saying it's okay to do anything. You know what I mean? Like, it should be okay for me to do whatever the fuck I want if this is a free fucking society. Yeah. But when it, I mean, is, I actually like,
is it, there, okay, there let's was re, an, let me rephrase that because I just stopped. Like, I have a bit about mental illness, and there's one line I would say, you can't say retard, or like I used to, if you can't say, people who say, you can say, I say it every night on the fucking, in that bit. So I've stopped and said it's unfashionable to say, but fuck, what were you just saying? God damn it.
Well, the whole is that it's not okay to make jokes. I think that there's certain people that are offensive.
Hang on. That's what I was trying to rephrase. Okay. It's not that it's not okay to talk about. The specific dialogue was it embraces or leads to rape culture.
Right.
When you make jokes about rape.
Right.
You're...
Well, and I will tend to agree with that. And this is the thing. It depends who the comic is, and it depends if you're fucking smart or if you're an asshole. And if you're a dumb asshole, you're going to get away with even less.
I think what you're trying to say is the context of the joke.
Exactly. Exactly.
Is rape the punchline or is rape the subject?
Exactly. So if you're... If you're Sarah Silverman and you're joking and you make a comment on the fact that women, you know, that women are brutalized and are raped because they're women, and that there's some joke in that it's coming from a place of the, not necessarily the victim, but like, this is fucked up. If you are raping people, you're an asshole and you're in the wrong. That joke is okay. If you're coming from a place like, ha ha ha, I'm gonna rape you because you don't like the joke I just told, and that's your comeback, and you know, as a comic, then you're an idiot. And like, all right, yes, you have the freedom to say that, but doesn't mean you're not an idiot.
Yeah, that the Tosh story that you
I
hear,
still don't know. I wasn't there. I don't know what he said, and I don't know the context.
The way an offended audience member hears something versus how a comic probably said it, and I know Dan Tosh, and I think he's a really funny comedian.
Yeah, but okay, I'm gonna even like I know, I don't know him. I don't know what he said. I only know what I read, and honestly,
well, you kind of alluded to what the blog was, so
exactly.
I wanted to clear that up.
But I'm not going to say that's, you know, that is necessarily even what happened. I know that other comics do. That is their joke, you know, that essentially threatening to rape people. The issue is that if you're coming from a place where a woman is heckling you, and because she's a woman, your immediate response is to threaten rape or to bring up rape, then that is coming from a place of misogyny. And I am not one to want to, I don't like that line. But there's a, if it's the comic and they're coming from, they're just like in the moment, I understand what it's like.
In the moment,
you just are defensive. But the problem is, and this, I know you're wanting to get in here. Because you were talking about promoting rape culture, and I think that is a problem. Because the problem is that a lot of comics who have a fine line between their smart commentary and their making fun of the douchebaggery, if I may say, of society, is that the douchebags who are part of that very same douchebaggery, they do not realize that they are actually the ones being laughed at. They think they're the ones that are making the jokes. And the problem is that when you have someone who's on the stage and is the center of attention, and he is not making it clear, like, this is wrong, this is not wrong, this is funny because people get hurt, that's where it, like, the line is fine.
I absolutely agree with you, but as a, because I know my audience, and I've been attacked this way myself. And you know what? You're absolutely right. I have a huge chunk of douchebags that are fans of mine.
Indeed you
that,
do.
That think that the tit fuck joke, as an old example, was a if you're new to my fucking show, I told my girlfriend I wanted to fuck her between the tits. She said, how are you gonna make that feel good for me? I said, right before I come, I'll stop punching you in the face.
Jesus,
it was Christ. Just this like stupid one-liner, like, when the checks are dropping, I gotta throw out some just shock value dumb shit that I had. And I'm just using that as a short example.
No, that's a great example, though, because, and I know you, and I know that that doesn't come from some fucking, like, I hate women, I think women should be beaten.
Yeah, and I don't even have jokes like that anymore. But,
no, I know.
But I use that as a short example of, there's people that hear what I'm saying, and then I have a bunch of drunks that know, oh, he's a drunk, and he says fuck a lot. So, yeah, they're not going to see...
Yeah. Well, and they take what you say literally, and they think that because you make a joke about something that they may actually do, that makes it funny. When in fact, what a lot of people who are not comics, and I find I notice this on Facebook all the time, like with comics Facebook pages, is that you'll have someone who's actually a smart comic who is like doing this for a fucking living, and he knows what he's doing, and he'll post something, and then you get a bunch of fucking losers commenting on it, then trying, like, I want Doug Stanhope to see my comment and think I'm funny, so I'm gonna say something, I'm gonna try and match it, and they're all stupid, and
that's
you're not reading it going like.
You're reading it going, oh my god,
these are my fucking fans, and I don't want to insult your fans because I know you have a lot of fucking intelligent fans, but you also have moron fans because everybody does, because there's fucking 95% of the world are morons.
That's my point. At what point are you responsible for how people take it?
Right.
So if you go, well, there's a section of the audience that if they don't understand that you're joking, well, how dumb do I have to make it? Because as a comic, I like to play to the smartest elements of the room. So at what point am I responsible for you being too dumb to get it and making you go rape?
Yeah.
Which I'm making that. That's how a lot of people put this out. Like, a bad rape joke, if not delivered properly, leads directly to a rape, is how a lot of people summed up this whole.
Well, I know. It's interesting. And it's that, Well, and it could. That's the scary thing, is it fucking could.
Hang on.
Or it could someone, like, justify what they are, the rape they just did the night before.
What if you, having a cavalier attitude about your own rape, makes listeners think, see, some chicks dig it.
Oh my god. Are you suggesting that?
that's what they're suggesting with the rape joke leading to rape culture. If what if someone doesn't get that you have somehow overcome this and you've not collapsed into some shivering victim and you could make jokes about it yourself? That's the same argument. I know what the people who talk about rape culture
mean. But see, what you just said is what I fear, what I brought up before, that scares me, because sometimes, a lot of the time, I feel like I can't express myself the way I want to express myself because it's not quote unquote normal, that I need to be more serious, that I'm not allowed to have my sense of humor because people might take it the wrong way and it might promote something that is not. I mean, I was brutalized and it was the worst thing that could ever happen to anyone, and it destroyed my life and is still. I'm fucking living in London, Ontario now, for Pete's sake. I'm not an actor. I'm not a comedian. Like, it was bad, but I am able to not be dead and not have fucking killed myself, like overdosing on blow or fucking Vicodin or a combination of the two.
You don't overdose on those two things.
What's that?
You don't really overdose.
You can have a heart attack doing too much coke.
Yeah, that's not an overdose. It's a heart attack.
All right.
You can have
Valium and Vicodin
was
dangerous.
You don't overdose on cheeseburgers over
Vicodin
a course of decades.
Vicodin and Valium and alcohol was a very dangerous combination for me. And then adding the blow onto it, which was like the post-rape combination for me. That was like near, it could have been a near death experience.
Hang on, we have to go to commercial. Hey kids, have you been raped? Try alcohol and Valium. Nothing will chase those blues away like a Chardonnay and a painkiller or an Oxy. All right, we're back to the podcast already in progress.
I'm so glad you have these tailor-made sponsors. I'm honored.
Well, that's where if Chaley would overproduce this and we'd go back and actually do that written out version of the Valium and alcohol for as a rape. I'm trying to have a big vocabulary. I don't have one. So did you get any shit when you were doing stand up about it? No, obviously not.
No. It's not like I was, you know, selling at stadiums or anything.
Have you ever been offended by a rape joke? As a former stand-up comic, you probably don't even watch comedy anymore, because once you've done it, it's ruined.
No, I do. And I'm not doing it anymore, and so it makes, like... I love comedy. I'm a comedy nerd at heart. Yeah. For sure. Yeah, I couldn't, you know, I don't have any short-term memory, so or long-term memory for that matter, I wouldn't know what. But yeah, there are people who have said stuff where I'm like, I don't know if that's really appropriate.
We were both boozers in our day, and well, my sun's still shining, is all I'm saying. Sarah Silverman you brought up, mm-hmm. and I can't think of an example, but I think if she were doing the exact same jokes as a man, she'd get shit all over, especially like rapey kind of jokes. I think it was Adam Carolla who once put it into the words that mm-hmm. I said, yes, her comedy comes from a male perspective. Her jokes.
I see. That's interesting, because I connect to that because people have said that about me. That's why I like her, because I think it is sort of a, you know, when you're a woman and yet you don't necessarily feel like girly, you know, it's like you relate, you have more guy friends, you relate more to what, you know, more to guys, you have more of a male perspective.
Sarah Silverman, unless
but I don't know what that means. She is a woman. So is there, she
specifically, if she's not talking about a vagina or a guy could do her act, and it wouldn't seem like that's out of place. Like the jokes, if she's doing jokes, mm-hmm. they're not necessarily I'd have to be watching her right now to go see.
Yeah, that's
what anyone would be upset if a man said that, or anyone could be upset.
Right, but she's not a man, and I don't know what her personal experience is, and I don't know where her jokes from. And I wish fuck I could like quote something but a right lot now of that her she
jokes,
says. But
yeah, a lot of her jokes are jokes. There's no meaning behind it. It's
I don't know that. I don't know if you know that or not. But the point is that she. Is that they come from someplace that's genuine, and whether it's experience or not.
I have
one. Okay, cool.
The one about, I blew a Mexican once. I had diarrhea for a week. There's no social, underlying. That's just a joke. So that's a fucking great joke. The homeless guy who kept, every time she went to the liquor store, there's a homeless guy going, I want pussy. And I could tell by looking at this man that this is a man. And she goes, there was grown up, he didn't have the love, and he grew up without enough pussy. I raped that joke. I'm sorry,
yeah,
Sarah Silverman.
I don't know what we're talking about now.
I did a complete injustice to that joke.
I just don't, I think as soon as you get into that position of like, well, if that was a guy telling that, that wouldn't be okay. But the point is, it's not a guy saying it. So if it was a guy who had an experience, that same guy, like Louis C.K. has some rape jokes that are perfectly acceptable because he's coming from a place where he's like, we are men and we are the ones doing the raping and we are fucked.
But the difference. There's rape as a subject and rape as a punchline.
Right.
And the show just started and it's going to bleed into this. Mm. And now we're going to, so part three
is coming up, London, Ontario.
And we're going to be drunk. So you're going to hear a whole different patter. And part three, back after this message. TheShadyDell.com. That is where you stay. If you come to Bisbee and you're staying at the Shady Dell and I'm in town, I will have a beer with you. I won't hang out that long. We're not going to be good friends. I don't want you to fucking tell me you're going to kill yourself. But if you're staying at TheShadyDell.com, vintage trailer park with all 50s, 60s trailers that we live a mile away from and we look for reasons to go stay there, come to TheShadyDell.com. Sponsored by, I might even come in and clean your toilet. I don't know. And we're back. The next day after a terrible show in London, Ontario. And then we did take a stab at cleaning this up with the part three last night. And the other comedians as an audience and... But yeah, we woke up and decided we were both too pickled and we should just try to do that clean. I don't really remember how it ends.
No, neither do I. I think it was a little bit of a clusterfuck and might not be a bad idea to do a do-over.
Yeah. We're cutting ahead 10 years anyway after this happens. And you get a call, you get a letter.
Oh, that's right. We didn't talk about any of that. I had just moved to Vancouver. I finally was like, you know what? I'm leaving LA. I'm leaving the rape shit. I can't deal with it anymore. And like a month later, I get a call from a friend and the LAPD had shown up on her doorstep because I had changed my LA address to her house just to keep getting, US mail stuff. And I immediately knew, I was like, oh, Jesus Christ, they fucking found the guy. And so I'm like calling all these numbers. I finally get through. And yeah, that's exactly what had happened. 10 years later, his DNA had matched, DNA in this, or they found a match in the database and he was arrested. So then it took another 2 years to, or wait, two
did
years,
you flip
three
out?
Years. It was, well, I, no, I don't know. If, well, it was pretty crazy. It was like, I honestly had never really thought that it would happen. It wasn't ever really even important to me necessarily because it just, I didn't think it was ever going to happen. The thought of it really had never crossed my mind.
Did you have to fly immediately down and identify the guy?
Nothing happens immediately in the justice system. But I did no. Actually, they were able to fax a photo lineup to Vancouver PD. So I did the photo lineup there and picked him out immediately. And then I guess there was a preliminary hearing, a year, just over a year after that. Like, it took a year to then, you know, bring to something. And then it took another 2 years to finally, he pled guilty just in September of this last year. And
so you were there for that?
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I was there. I was there for the sentencing. He pled guilty. And then a month later is when they flew me to L.A. to speak at the sentencing hearing.
OK. And you had asked the judge or the prosecutor?
I had been talking a lot with the prosecutor over the years, trying to, you know, just figuring out like my end of it. And I was always pretty vocal about the fact I don't believe in the throwing people in jail, you know, tossing the key and just thinking that that's actually going to do something. I really wanted him to have to face me and talk to me, and it didn't really turn out exactly how I wanted it, because we weren't allowed to have dialogue, which was really too bad. And I still hope one day I want to go visit him in jail. I'd like to be able to talk to him over the years and finally get to a point where I can get through to him.
Why did you do this?
Yeah, because he was still like, went at the
dude, what's up?
Yeah. He was like, he had a brain injury, and so he was still sort of, you know, playing the whole, oh, I don't really remember this. It's, and I know part
as
of it
coached
is,
by an attorney.
Well, his attorney actually didn't even want him to be saying some of the stuff he was saying at the sentence. She kept interrupting, you know. I would be talking directly to him, and I would ask him questions, and he would start to answer, and she'd be like, I don't think this is a good idea. And he, you know, I think he will be ready to talk at some point when it doesn't, you know, it doesn't matter anymore now. He won't have anyone protecting him or, you know, speaking for him. And there was nothing.
And what he got sentenced to?
20 years.
All right.
Yeah. Which is honestly, if he had gone to trial, he could have possibly not got that much, because, you know, the one thing they always, you know, the, juries in LA can be very left-leaning and hear sob stories and, you know, not want people to see long prison terms. And I didn't really care. And I didn't want to go through the whole trial thing. It takes so fucking long. Like, the justice system is just ridiculous. And I, you know, 20 years, yeah, I was, you know, he's already like in his 60s. And, you know, I just wanted him to be responsible.
Have you written to him?
No, I haven't yet. I honestly don't really know how to do it. I would like to do that. But I just, you know, it happened.
Oh, that's right. You don't even know his name.
Trejo. It is Trejo.
All right.
His name, again, is not. It was one of the things I said to him at the sentencing hearing, was that I had never even thought, like, what is this guy's name? It wasn't important. He wasn't a human being. And a part of it was like, I kind of had to acknowledge that he was a human being, because he is.
I know. I just thought it was funny. Like, if you ever ran into him in public and you're like, you're the guy that raped me. what's your name again? I'm sorry. I can't. I black a lot of stuff out.
Well, I would hope that I don't ever run into him. I don't even want to think about that possibility. But yeah, no. It's,
well, if you visit him in prison,
yeah. Well,
because you do want to ask him, like, what the fuck?
Yeah, exactly. Well, you know, and I'm curious.
Without a lawyer there saying, you don't answer that.
Exactly. Like, I was never interested in just like in sitting and yelling at him or judging him, being like, you destroyed my life, which he did. I mean, I did tell him that he did, you know, ruin so many parts of my life that will, you know, I'll never know what my life could have been like if this didn't happen to me. It sort of, you know, redefined what the fuck I'll do with the rest of my life. But I really just want to find out, like, who are you? Like, what the hell was going on in your life that this is the fucking shit you were doing? Like, you know, and just find out, like, what gets a person to that place. And I don't think there's any justification, obviously, ever. But I think the problem with most, you know, it's like, it's like what we were talking about, like, you know, whether you can make a rape joke or not. It's like, there's this silence about the whole fucking issue. Like, no one wants to talk about the fact.
Not on this podcast, there isn't.
No one ever wants to talk about the fact that this shit happens. And why the hell does it happen? Why does a fucking, you know, all-star football player in his first year of college think that he can just take a woman and think that that's acceptable and have his whole team basically defend him and, you know, pretend it didn't happen? Why does this guy do this to me? Why do people, you know, it's like, I don't understand it. And I think I need to joke about it because it makes me fucking sane, or it's an attempt at sanity. But to joke about it in terms of like belittling that this is happening, that's the problem. Because why the fuck is this happening? It's really like if you
well, that's yeah that's you what that's
meet,
why
and,
we
you meet
redoing
women, most
this.
Of them have had this happen to them in one way or another, and that is like that is creepy. What the fuck?
Yeah, this is what got us off track yesterday, right? When we did this is when we had talked to the other girl, and then a million branches of this conversation started to
right. It's just it's
but yeah no a lot of women have this these kind not like you not you know beaten into looking like the kid from Mask right. But so I mean there's a million different varieties of
right.
sexual abuse of some level
yeah most people it's like it was like their fucking family member or someone that they trusted, which to me is way worse than what happened to me. Like I said before, like I had no expectations of this person.
Diddled like a Duggars.
Yeah, exactly. It's fucking disgusting. And like, you know, yeah, perfect example. And like the whole right wing crazy Christian whatever is just kind of passing that off as normal. Like, oh, it's just innocent curiosity. Really? Really? Like touching your 5-year-old sister is just a normal curiosity, and then just
all of your 5-year-old
yeah,
exactly, sisters,
yeah. All 10 of them. Jesus, it's so fucked up. But yeah.
Well, if you'd like to visit him in prison, we'll pay for the date.
Well, I might take you up on that. Yeah, I will. You know, I honestly really.
Do you know where he's in prison?
No, actually, I probably should know that too.
I'm sure you'd find
out. I kind of just tuned out after, like, I did my thing in court, and then
wait,
went like viral. Yeah, that's the weird.
I forgot the whole PR thing. You had a friend that did PR,
right.
And she had you write up a press release,
right?
Because you were going to confront your attacker,
right? Right. Yeah. Well,
in court,
you know, over the years, like. Whenever rape comes into the news, like whether it was like the Daniel Tosh thing, it's like some, you know, comedian joke thing everybody's offended about, or whether it's this or that, or, you know, some football player did something or other at some university somewhere, you never fucking hear from the people it happened to. And they are everywhere. It's not like they're hard to come by. But for some reason, we never hear from the people who've been raped. And it really
not
always
usually
pisses me off.
Not really usually all that chatty.
No, and I don't understand why, honestly. Like, I don't judge them for not doing what I'm doing. You know, it's like, it's a little odd that I will just speak so openly. I, you know, realize that. But I think that people do want to talk about it more than they do. I think that a lot of the shame that people put on being raped is actually put on them by other people. It's not what they feel necessarily. They start to feel it because other people are embarrassed and shame
so
and
you,
feel shame.
So you write up a press release.
Yeah, I basically was like, I was raped. This is my name. I'm not like, I went to the Santa Monica Rape Treatment Center, and I was like, I spoke at one of their fundraisers right after it happened to me. And I remember them, like, they didn't want me to give out my name. And I was like, I would like to say who I am. I'm not embarrassed. I'm not hiding. And they actually insisted that I not identify myself. And I always sort of, I didn't like it for years. It pissed me off. It's like, don't fucking tell me I can't say who I am. So I wrote this press release. My friend Karen, who's a publicist, you know, just sent it out. And I didn't know. This was like 2 days before I went to LA, or the day before. Actually, I was editing the press release, waiting for my waiting on my layover in Toronto, and on my way to LA.
So
I get there
time.
The next morning, and Karen's like, "Did you see all the TV cameras in the courtroom?" And I was like, "What? No." She's like, "How did you not?" And I'm like, "Oh, I guess I just thought they were part of that was always there." And she's like, "They're here for you." I was like, "Oh, whoa, this is real. Okay." And then, you know, they did like a little, did the thing, and I talked to the guy for about half an hour, and the whole thing was on camera. Of course, I don't have any fucking record of it. The whole point was that I wanted to archive what was happening. Only the TV stations did it. Iowa didn't have
my own
camera. No, I tried to get it. They wouldn't, like, they said that they record over everything within 24 hours. They take the bits that they edit into the, I mean, maybe it exists out there, and no one, they just
can't help
me.
Are there clips out there?
Yeah, there's tons online. I keep meaning to like download it so that it doesn't just disappear someday, but of course I haven't done that either.
Hopefully Chaley can find something.
It's not difficult. Because there was a bunch of different news stations there, and then there were some radio stations, and it went viral. It was pretty crazy. Like, it was just like people.com picked up the story and had my fucking photo.
Fox and CNN
I don't know about CNN. I don't think so.
News sources.
But yeah, it was very weird. And then it was over.
It'd be a weird way to get an agent.
I remember thinking, like, seriously, like, all the years I was training as an actor and, like, working in Hollywood and doing stand-up and doing whatever, and this is how I get attention.
This is my 15 minutes.
Great. I like the fact that I can do it because I think it's important. This is what I wanted to talk about, is that I wanted to be able to talk about it because, first of all, nobody does. But second of all, nobody talks about it like I do. And I am constantly feeling like I'm doing something wrong by joking, by being me and, like, just being as open as I am by, joking uncomfortably about certain things. I've done some public speaking and, make jokes about it. I always, like, compare my face to Rocky Dennis like I did. Just sort of weird little things. And, like, I'm not your typical sort. I don't know what a typical rape victim is. But
you know that you're better than the other ones.
I don't I don't think it's about being better. It's happened to my life and it's my life and I do things in a different way. And it's a weird thing to feel like I have to sort of cater, like, oh, I have to, I have to be the strong woman and I have to be empowering and I do, like, inspirational. And it's like, and there are people, you have such courage. And it's like, I don't think it's, I have courage. I just don't want to be fucking silent. Like, don't tell me to shut up because this shit happened to me. Like, well, that's not courage.
We here at the Doug Stanhope podcast appreciate your candor, your levity in a dark situation. And is there any way that you can segue from the rape into an audible.com drop? All right, we'll just save that for another day. All right, Jane Piper. Find Jane Piper at Facebook.
We have a page. I should know what this is called. Jane Piper's. Google my name, but Jane Piper's
says
survivor. Jane Piper's survivor, rape survivor story. Oh God, I should.
Fuck it. Just Google search Jane Piper. You'll find her. Jane Piper. Better rape victim than you.
Oh, stop it! Jesus Christ. You can't end like that.
Yeah, no, I'm not going to.
Say something clever.
So just Google search. He'll cut that out. So just Google search Jane Piper Facebook. And we look forward to the book that you're definitely going to finish this year. I Was Raped and All I Got Is This Lousy T-Shirt is the name of the book that she will be done with by the end of the year. And hopefully it'll be on the shelves in 2016. Thank you very much. And we're on the road. We'll have more podcasts coming from Canada. And thanks for listening.
Dancing on, do the boogie all night. dancing on. Do the boogie all night long. Stoned in paradise. Shouldn't talk about it. Shouldn't talk about it.
Of you, suspense control in my mind. I cannot find the way out of here. I want you by my side so that I never feel alone again. And I want you, we can bring it on the floor. Never danced like this before. About it.